Okay, good morning students. Let me continue translation studies because I guess by October 26th or 27th or 28th we may have a mid-semester exam. For the mid-semester exam, for the paper literary forms, there are three units: introduction, first unit, second unit poetry, third unit prose. So these three units are for mid-semester exam in the for the paper literary forms. And for translation studies, first unit introduction, second unit history of translation, and the fourth unit problems in translation. Okay, so these three units are included for the mid-semester exam, and we completed three units in literary forms, but we haven't completed the second unit, history of translation. So let me complete the second unit, history of translation, so that it would be balanced. Okay, so for three units for this paper literary forms and three units for translation studies. So for these two papers you have to prepare three units. Okay, so hereafter let me complete translation studies, the second unit history of translation, and then we shall continue literary forms. Okay, and now we shall continue this Bible translation, and this video is the last unit for Bible translation. So we shall continue Bible translation, and in his circular letter on translation of 1530, Martin Luther says such emphasis on the significance that uses verbs Erbarsten, that is to translate, and Verdutschen, to Germanize almost indiscriminately. Okay, Martin Luther King in 1530, he sends a circular, okay, to everybody on translation. Okay, actually it is a translation theory. Unknowingly he wrote this translation theory. This letter is said to be a translation theory, and why this letter is considered to be a translation theory? Because he talks about translation, how it is translated, in what all the way a good translation could be done. Likewise, he sent a circular letter to pay everybody. Okay, so in that letter, Martin Luther King clearly mentioned that to translate and to and the German translation, that is to Germanize, both are same. Okay, and that's how he uses. Of course, there are difference between these two words in the German language itself. Yet Martin Luther King doesn't discriminate the meaning of these two words to translate as well as to Germanize, that is a German translation. So both are equal. That's how Martin Luther King uses in this in his circular. And Martin Luther also stresses the importance of relationship between style and meaning. Grammar is necessary for declension, conjugation, and construction of sentences. But in speech, the meaning and subject matter must be considered, not grammar, for grammar shall not rule over the meaning. And Martin Luther King stresses the importance of the relationship between style and meaning, and he says that, finally he says that meaning is more important than style. Okay, style he refers as grammar, grammatical structure. Rather than focusing on linguistic aspects and grammatical structure, the translator should focus more on the meaning. Okay, so meaning it should be given more importance rather than rhyming words or grammatical structure and grammatical items. That's what Martin Luther King says about translation. And the Renaissance Bible translator perceived both fluidity and intellectual ability in TL text as important criteria. They are equally concerned with the transmission of literally accurate message. So the Renaissance Bible translators, they say that fluidity and intelligibility, that is to read fluently, okay, that is to make the TL readers understand, okay. So the main aim of Bible translation is that to make common readers to understand Bible. So that is their main aim, and at the same time they should have the intelligibility about word of God. And above these things, the Renaissance translators say that the more importance should be given to accurate message, accurate meaning. So meaning is the most important thing in Bible translation. That's what Renaissance Bible translator also say. In an age when choice of pronoun could mean the difference between life and condemnation of to death, as heretic precision was of central importance. See, the heretic, that is the faith, the religious faith, that is more important in Bible translation. And if we cannot ignore it, okay. And say the pronoun, okay. For sake of respect, in Tamil language, we say "nee ningal," okay. Actually, the word "ningal" is the meaning is plural form of second person, you, okay. In the English language, there is no such kind of difference between difference of singular and plural of a second person. So even if it is singular, you have to say you. Even if it is plural, you have to say you. Okay. And that alone is not going to be the problem. But where the problem is, in Tamil language, we say even though the second person is singular, we use the plural neengal just for sake of respect. Okay. Similarly, in all languages, just for sake of respect, we use singular or even third person. But in case of English language, you don't even if it is to give respect, we have to use the pronoun he, that alone. Okay. So this is the problem in translation. But above all, we have to give importance to the scripture, the religious faith in it. Okay. And so, and that's why in English, if you want to refer Jesus Christ as he, we have to use the capital H. Okay. So though it is violating the grammatical rule, we must use to refer Jesus Christ by using pronoun he. We have to write capital H. Okay. So that's how in English Bible translation Jesus Christ is referred. And we have to violate certain grammatical rules and regulations. Then only the meaning is conveyed and the faith is also conveyed. Okay. Because Bible translation was integral part of upward shift in the status of vernacular, the question of style was also vital. And we have to give, see, meaning is most important thing, there is no doubt in it. And if possible, the translator should give importance to style also. Okay. For sake of style, the translator should not compromise the meaning. If at all there is scope that the style meaning is not compromised, at the same time style is also maintained, then both should be followed. And that's what Renaissance Bible translators say. And Luther advised the would-be translator to use vernacular proverb or express if it fitted with fitted in with a New Testament. In other words, to add wealth of imagery in the SL text by drawing on vernacular tradition too. Okay. See, Martin Luther King also says that the proverb, okay, proverb could be translated in vernacular, the related vernacular proverb itself. Okay. See, time and tide waits for none. In Tamil, we say, Adi Kodara, Amma Yuse Kodara, Varampa. Let's say, if we literally translate நேரமும் காற்றும் யாருக்கும் காத்திருக்காது. தட்ஸ் ஹவ் வி ஹவ் டு டிரான்ஸ்லேட். பட் டைம் அண்ட் டைட் வெயிட்ஸ் ஃபார் நன் அண்ட் அமாவாசை ஆடி கொடுத்தா அண்ட் அமாவாசை கொடுத்தா வர்றது. ஸோ தட் இஸ் த மீனிங் ஆர்ஸ் எக்ஸாக்ட்லி சேம், பட் த லிட்டில் மீனிங் ஆர் கம்ப்ளீட்லி டிஃப்ரெண்ட். ஓகே. ஸோ தெர்ஃபோர் the target language related proverb should be used rather than a word for word translation, and that is what Martin Luther King also says. And since the Bible is itself a text that each reader must reinterpret in reading, each successive translation attempts to allay doubts in the wording and offer readers a text in which they may put their trust. In the preface to King James Bible of 1611, entitled "The Translator to a Reader," the faith. See, the another problem for Bible translator is that first of all they have to maintain the faith. They have to convey the faith. That is the most important thing. And whenever the Bible is a scripture and it has to be read again and again, daily again and again, it has to be read. And whenever they read Bible, they should have more meaning and they should have more faith. First thing is that Bible is a scripture and it should be read again and again. When we read again and again, we should develop more faith in Christianity. That is the first factor. And as we read Bible again and again, there should be scope for reinterpretation. Okay, there should be scope for various layers of meaning. So this is also another problem. And whenever they read again and again, the trust on God should be developed. Keeping these things in mind, the Bible should be translated. And let me tell about King James version of Bible in 1611. Actually, you should have studied in history of English literature also. There are various versions of English Bible translation. All English people should have one version of of English Bible translation. And so King James decided, he appointed approximately 200 to 300 translators. And there is for the 200 to 300 translators, there were he appointed 16 head translators. And with lots of research, and they took almost 10 years to complete this a common version of Bible translation in English. Okay. And finally this version is called as the King James version, because it was he who sponsored, and it was he who helped the translators to translate, and with lots of research, and this translation was made. And this is the King James version of Bible is considered to be is considered as the best one, and it is used all over the world. Okay. And there in that King James version of Bible, in the preface, the question is asked, the kingdom of God words or syllables. So what does this question mean? So whether translators should translate God's word or God's syllables. Okay. There are differences. See, God's syllables is in the sense sound. Okay, there is no point in translating sound. We have to translate God's words. Okay, so therefore the style is style and word for our word translation is not given importance. Sense translation is given importance. Then the task of translator went beyond linguistic and became evangelistic in their own right. For translator of Bible in 16th century was radical leader in the struggle to further man's spiritual progress. So the translator, let's say, for Bible translation, the translator is not a linguistic scholar, rather he is an evangelist. That is he spreads Christianity. Therefore, the translator should have powerful faith in Christianity, and he is doing the job of spreading Christianity to the world. Okay, so keeping this in the mind, that the Bible should be translated, and man has for a man will have a man has forever an eternal spiritual struggle in the on this earth. Okay, so therefore, to reduce the struggle, man's struggle for spiritual progress, Bible is essential. Bible translation should be done, and for that, the translators are doing an evangelistic job. That is a divine job that the translators are doing with the faith and spreading the God's words. The collaborative aspect of Bible translation responds to yet another significant aspect of the struggle. So that is translators, especially Bible translators, are doing a great job, that is spread of Christianity, and King James version of Bible translation is supposed to be the best English version of Bible translation. Okay, with this, this topic Bible translation is over, and we shall move to next topic in history of translation. Thank you.